Hallelujah. Lord Jesus, we praise you and we bless you because your name is a strong and mighty tower. The righteous run to that name and they are saved. Lord, we are grateful to you. Oh, turns our mourning into dancing. You, Lord, who gives us the victor's crown. Yes, you, Lord Jesus, who has our names written on the palms of your heart. What a joy, what a glory, what a blessing, what a privilege, Lord, to praise our God and to know that in the billions of the multitudes of this world, our names are on the palm of your hand this morning. You know us by name. You know our situations, Lord. You know our pains and our sorrows. You put laughter in our
level. don't know what this will be done for this feedback. Now, that's our theme. And our theme verse is Isaiah 43 and verse 19. Paul, are you in the house? Paul, my friend, young one. Paul, are you in the house? My friend, Paul, the young man. Is he in the house? Oh, he's not in the house. We agreed that he will. He's the one who did the theme verse, but he's not there. I believe because it depends on parents to be here, maybe there was something. But I want to remind us that our theme verse is verse 19, and it says, before verse 19, it is verse 18. It says, forget the former things. That is verse 18. Forget the former things. Don't dwell in them. Verse 19 says, behold, I'm doing a new thing. See, that is the NIV. See, I do a new thing. Now it is springs forth. It is coming forth. Don't you perceive it? I am making a way in the desert, and I'm making streams of water in the wasteland. That's our theme verse. And as we do this, and as we move with our theme, I just want to remind us, please do something to this microphone, okay? And use the other one. Hallelujah. Let me use this one. Now, I want to let you know, church, as we move, as we talk about this time for the next level, I want to pray that I began the first Sunday, and we were talking about forget the former things. So the second Sunday, we spoke about discovering the path. The third Sunday, we spoke about preparing the path. And last Sunday, we were talking about advancing, where you move to the next level. And we say that we acknowledge that we are helpless without God. And then we acknowledge, like we realize we are helpless without God, then we realize that God is sufficient. We have sufficiency in God. For that reason, we are able to advance to the next level, because He is the one doing the new thing, leading us to the next level. You may not even have an idea of what is awaiting you, but God is taking us there. But we also say that we will set about three things or four, that we are trusting God to take us to the next level. Those ones that we know, we put them down. And those that we want to, the things that have held us back, we are saying the things we want to forget. Three of them, we write them down and trust God to forget them so that we can move to the next level. And therefore, moving to the next level, last Sunday we say, for us to move, we must persist, we must persevere so that we can possess that place. And today, I want us to move on, and because we move to the next level, we want to say, and we want to trust God to help us, that once we move to the next level, we want to maintain the place. We want to remain there. And if anything happens, we will not go down. We will move to another level. It is important that we maintain the place. And so my topic tonight and this morning, or rather, my topic is my sermon is remaining in the path. In other words, maintaining the next level. And another way, remaining secure in that level. As we speak about this, I want to let you know, as a church, we are not just talking about going to the next level. It is not a few days, but I want to remind the church that we are in war. We are in battle. We have an enemy. It's not just coming in church and going. It is not talking about the next level. We have an enemy. But praise the Lord, we have a shepherd. And I say His will is that we move to the next level. He wants us to be the next level. You have heard me say again and again, God's will for you, visitor or regular, it is that He wants you to go to the next level. Can I hear somebody? Yes. Hallelujah. Did you hear me? Yes. I want to say it again and again here. God's will for us is the next. God's will for you is the next level. But I say the path for next level is not always clear, like we are moving up. Sometimes you may look defeated. But you know what, as we sang, the glory of the Lord is upon me. The favor of the Lord is upon me. And the devil knows I am a winner. Did I hear a victor in the house? Hallelujah. I want to remind you that as we move to the next level, as we persist, as we persevere, and we get to that place, I want to remind you that that enemy out there is watching and is not asleep. We need to stand. But number one, I want to remind you, I have five things that I will put and I will bring them to you as the Lord help me, and then we'll be done. But let me bring you, church, to this place. The Bible, the one that we are reading, the theme verse, it is from the book of Isaiah. And God was speaking to Israel, rather Judah, and they were in captivity. Now, these people had been delivered from Egypt. They were brought through the wilderness by God. They were brought to the land of promise. And when they came in there, as we said, they were victorious. Joshua led them. They moved from one level to another. They took possession of the land. They moved to the next level. Praise the Lord. They moved from this level to another. And God defeated the kings and the rulers of the land of promise and gave them the land. They moved to greater heights. And then you know what? During the times of the judges, there were defeats here and there. If you read the book of Judges, they were not moving to the next level. One judge will come and they move up. And then sometimes they will go down. This is not the will of God that you go up and you go down. God wants us to move forward. And this is what happened to them. In the book of Judges, it happened then Samuel came as the last judge and he moved them forward. And you know what happened in the times of Samuel, they asked for a king. And they got Saul. And there was a lot of defeat. There were some victories, but a lot of defeat during the time of Saul. And he died in shame. It was terrible. And David took over. And when David took over, praise the Lord, Israel moved. The Bible says that David took the land of Canaan. David went to the boundaries that God had given to Abraham. The boundaries that were meant to be under the land of promise. David conquered. Hallelujah. After David conquered, you know that is the will of God. The Bible says that he did the will of God. And when he finished his work, he slept. That is the will of God. That you move, keep moving to the next level. And when time is over, mine is over, I will sleep. After there is a testimony that you serve God in your generation. Can I hear an amen? Amen. That is the will of God. And what happened? Rather than moving to the next level, eventually Israel slipped back into idolatry. Their kings were defeated. They were split into two kingdoms. If you read the Bible and see what happened, what was the last thing? Captivity. They were taken to captivity, the lowest. It was shame. It was the place that God never intended that they would be, but that's where they are. So as we read the book of Isaiah, it is that these people would have remained secure in the land, but they went to captivity. God forbid that when we get to the next level, we will not be careful, we will slide back, and then we are coming from captivity. God forbid, my prayer, none of us will slide back in Jesus' name. So then, God has given us the next level. How do we ensure we remain secure? Keep the estate we have acquired. I have five things. Number one, be sober. Be sober. Hear me. These are not exhaustive, but this is what the Lord led me. Number one, you want to remain secure in that next level. Be sober. That is, think right. Now, the word sober is translated from the Greek word that means to be calm and corrected. You know, I have a problem with L and R, but I want to emphasize what I mean. This is the problem with the mother tongue where I was raised. This is not my own. This is where I found myself. But it's okay, I can communicate. I'm saying you are collected. It is L. You know, collecting together. Somebody who is collected, you are not scattered. That's what I mean. You are sober. That's what I mean. It is translated, that word means calm and collected. To have a good sense, good judgment. That is, you are collected, you are calm, you have good sense, you have good judgment. You want to remain secure. Good judgment. It also means wisdom and having, being level-headed. You know, level. That means it's not uneven. You are level-headed. I love this word. These are just English words. But I believe that the issue of alcohol, when we talk about being sober, is not being drunk. This came later. This is also okay, you know. If you are not drunk, you are sober. If you are not under the influence of drugs, you are sober, isn't it? That we say. But from that, where it says, translated from Greek, it means calm, collected, having a good sense, good judgment, wisdom, and being level-headed. And so then, this kind of soberness, I want to bring it because I want to move fast. Now, this kind of soberness, I see it's in thinking this way, and this is where I want to go. Whatever you have at the level where God takes you, you have been taken there by God. So that means you are steward of whatever God gives you. Think sobre, good judgment will remind you. You are a steward. Once you are a steward owns nothing. Here in the biblical language, a steward owned nothing. He was a slave who managed his master's well. Do you know a slave? A slave who managed his master's well. Stewardship, I want to remind you and put it in your spirit. One of the things that will help you to be secure in the next level is that you are sober, you are level-headed, and you know you are a steward of that level. Hallelujah. Children of Israel, forget, they forgot. They were stewards of the land of promise. And what happened? They don't remain calm, collected, having good sense. Now, in the book of Luke chapter 12, the Bible talks about chapter 12. And from verse 11 to 19, if you read, and I know you know this story, there is what is sometimes referred at the top. They call him the rich fool. Now this, Jesus was speaking, gave a parable. And he said there is a man, and before Jesus spoke that, in verse 15, he says, watch out, be on guard from all kinds of greed. Man's life does not consist in the abundance of his possession. That is verse 15. I want to say again, as I see here, status is okay, riches are okay, but you know, God and our position in God is not determined by the status. And this is what Jesus was saying, that a man's life does not consist in the abundance of possession, but I pray that God will give you possessions. Hallelujah. The next level can be possession, isn't it? And so possession is not a problem. But he says that God, man's life does not consist in abundance of possession. Now Jesus said, a rich man planted, worked on his ground, and it produced a lot of crop. You cannot produce a lot of crop without hard work. This man was very hardworking. And when he looked at the crop, he said, this is giving a big harvest. What did he say? He said, what shall I do? Because this harvest, I don't have a place for it. He said, I'll pull down my storehouse. After pulling them down, I'll build bigger ones. And when I build bigger ones, then he said this. Then I will say to myself, you have plenty of good things, verse 19. Laid up for many years. Take life easy. Eat, drink, and make merry. But God said, you fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself? This is how it will be with anyone who stores up things for himself but is not rich towards God. Now, this riches towards God is what makes you secure. I read this and I thought about this story. Sometimes this man is judged very harshly. And I thought about it a bit. I thought, this man is hardworking, isn't it? This man moved to the next level because God was moving him there. It is God you plant, you water, but who gives the increase? It is God who blessed him. This is not the devil who blessed him. Jesus was saying, God blessed him. And I want to believe somehow, go with me somehow and with him, that this man was not a bad man. He was not ungodly. He worked hard. God blessed him. And he looked, who does not look ahead? You make plans and you realize these ones are not enough. You look ahead and you plan. We have 10-year plan, 20-year plan. We have 50-year plan. This was a man with a plan. Hallelujah. But you know the problem. When he looked at the next level, he was not sober. He did not think about stewardship. He said, man, you know, it is the kind that I have gotten there. Take life easy, eat and drink, and make merry. We are not defined by status in the eyes of God, but whether we are reaching God. This helps us not to hold back, but to release it. Give ourselves and give our goods. That is stewardship. Consider this, that this man, I think, was not a bad man, but I say, because he was consumed by things, not stewardship, he was risking his state. He was risking his level. And for that, I want to ask you, be sober. And remember, you are steward of the next level. For that reason, you will be secure. And as I wind up from there, I want to read you a scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter 4. The Bible says, verse 1, Paul is speaking. He says, so then, men ought to regard us as servants of Christ and as those entrusted with the secret things of God. Now, it is required that those who have been given a trust must prove faithful. If you read another version, it is actually talking about stewardship. Paul is saying, you ought to regard us as servants of Christ and the stewards of the sacred things of God. He's talking about his ministry. And then he says, it is required of those who are given the trust, that is stewards, they must prove faithful. When they prove faithful, they are secure. Now, Paul was talking about ministry. If you read before the opening of 1 Corinthians 4, chapter 3 to that the end, he is talking about Peter and Apollos and himself. The people in Corinth, they were comparing them. In fact, they were divided. And because of that, there was confusion. And so Paul is telling them, it is not about Peter. It's not about Paul. It is not about Apollos. It is about God who has given the gift. If Paul looks greater, if Apollos looks greater, if it is Peter who looks greater, none of them is great. They are stewards of the ministry. I want to turn it around. Whether ministry, whether business, whether career, whether education, whatever God gives you, it is a gift. And so Paul now goes down. Let me repeat it. Verse
I have applied this to myself and Apollos for your benefit, so that you may learn from us the meaning of the saying, do not go beyond what is written, remain in the word. Think soberly according to the scripture, as you think about others, as you think about yourself. Then the scripture says, then you will not take pride in one man over another. You will think soberly about me. I am your pastor. Pastor Mary is here. We are not here for a contention. You say this is greater than the other. We have leaders here. We have people here. I want you to realize it is God who gives us the gift. It is God who lifts us to the level. And when we get there, now Paul puts it this way. For who has made you different from anyone else? What do you have that you did not receive? And if you received it, why do you boast as though you did not receive it? What do you have that you did not receive? I want you to put that in your spirit. Remember, whatever level God will take you there, remember, there is nothing that I have that I did not receive. So if I received it, I will be sober. I am a steward. And that is number one, be sober. Number two, I move on. And we say it again, be sober. You are just a steward on the next level. That will make you be secure. Number two, be humble. Be humble. What is humility? I want to say humility is not a temperament. By temperament, I mean it is not a personality trait. You know, this is generally humble. This is generally not humble. I'm not talking about personality traits. You know, humility is a fruit of the Spirit. In fact, if you read chapter 5:24, where it talks of Galatians, meekness is one synonym of humility, meekness. And you know the Bible talks about Moses, he was humble. In fact, in his day, the Bible says there was no other that was as humble as him. So I'm saying, as we talk about humility, don't think about a personality trait. Say, you know me, I am not humble. You are talking about your nature. We are not talking about that. We are talking about something that God developed. And so what is humility? Humility, some other words for humility is that you're gentle, you're quiet, you're submissive. But humility is not timidity, it's not being fearful. Jesus was humble. If you read the book of Philippians chapter 2 from verse 5 going down to verse 10, we are told about Jesus and the humility that we should emulate him. Jesus was not fearful. Jesus was powerful. But as a man, he was humble. So humility is not timidity. It should not be confused with that. But God is the one who teaches us humility. God is working in us to develop humility. It can be painful, but it is a fruit that is developed by the Holy Spirit, and God is pleased by humility. Now, humility makes you remain secure and move to the next level. Now, just to bring in some maybe practical thing, and then Jesus was in a wedding. That is Matthew in Luke chapter 14, 7 to 11. And as he was in the wedding, he said that it's written that he saw people coming, guests coming in, you know. And he noticed some people were taking the front seats and the places of honor. And Jesus gave this parable. He said, if somebody invites you in a wedding feast, do not take the place of honor, for a person more distinguished than you may have been invited. Have you sat in a seat that you are moved behind? And do I have some experience? You know how it feels. Now, this kind of seat, because the opposite of humble is proud, is being full of yourself and feeling important, can take you there. And Jesus said, when you are invited, do not take that seat. If the host who invited you, both of you, will come and say to you, give this man your seat. Then, humiliated, you will have to take the least important place. But when you are invited, take the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he will say to you, friend, move up to a better place. Then you will be honored in the presence of all your fellow guests. Verse 11, Jesus said, for everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, will be humiliated. And he who humbles himself will be exalted. I want to warn you, church, remain humble. That is, those who are humble, they are not full of themselves. You know, when you are proud, it tells you, you are the best. By the way, be the best. It is to be your best. And we need every one of us to be our best. But when you are your best, don't go around thinking you are the best of all. Now, that is different. When you become your best, that is okay. But when you impose your best to all and think you are the best of all, that is pride. Are we together, church? I'm explaining this, that we want to be the best. Even in the church, we want to be our best. But when we are in our best, we will not go around saying the best church. Eshitam Kiapurot, who said it? God wants us to be our best. God wants us to be in our purpose and to be at the top of where he ordained us to be. Hallelujah. So God wants to be your best. But you know, pride makes you, once you get there, or you are there, you are the most important. I know this happens. And this is what we are saying in pride. Once you get to the next level, and you are there, you are in your best, rejoice. Be humble. I want to speak to people. I want to speak to us. You know, when the Lord lifts us to that place, and when you are there, you are saying, they are not hardworking. These guys, you know. And you know, that is how pride comes. You know, we need a prayer. That's why we are the best church. Let me tell you, by grace, we are doing this. It is the anointment of God, and I pray in Sitam Kiapuro will be sober. We will be humble as the Lord lifts us to the next level. The Bible says that humility will keep you there, and not only keep you there, the Bible says you will be exalted. You will move to other levels. Hallelujah. I see something different here. You not only exalted. The other levels you are looking for, humility. Let me move on fast because I must finish this. Number three, be thankful. Be thankful. Be sober. Be humble. Be thankful. Now, if you read 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 18, verse 16 says, rejoice evermore. This is Paul writing. The next one he says, pray without ceasing, verse 17. And verse 18 of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 says, and in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ concerning you. In everything give thanks. Be thankful. Let me tell you, Paul knew how to give thanks. He was not just speaking. If you read in the epistle, you can write down Romans chapter 1 verse 8. Just put that one down. Romans chapter 1 verse 8. 1 Corinthians 1 4. Ephesians 1 6. Philippians 1 3. Colossians 1 6. 1 Thessalonians 1 2. 1 Timothy 2 1. And Philemon 1:4. All these letters, in all these letters, Paul says, I give thanks because of you. He gave thanks because of the Roman church. He gave thanks because of the Corinthian. He gave thanks because of the Ephesians. He gave thanks because of the Philippian. He gave thanks because of the Colossian. He gave thanks because of the Thessalonian. He gave thanks because of Philemon. Paul knew how to be thankful. And the Bible says in the book of Psalms 50:23, whoever offers praise
glorifies me. Whoever offers praise glorifies me. And to him who orders his conduct right, I will show the salvation of God. That is the New King James Version. I like the way the NIV puts it. It says this: whoever sacrifices thank offering honors me, and he prepares the way so that I may show him the salvation of God. I like this. When you praise, you are giving thanks. And whoever offers thank offering prepares a way for the Lord to move them to the next level. They are secure. I like this. The best defense. And somebody finish for me. The best defense is offense. Did you hear me? Can I see your hand? Can I see your hand? Can I hear it? The best defense? Let's say it. The best defense is offense. What do I mean? If you allow the enemy to stay at your border, you are vulnerable. They can come anytime. What do you do with that enemy? Push them back. Hallelujah. You don't allow the enemy to stay there. If an army is fighting the enemy, they don't fight and then they leave them there. No, you push them, defeat them. What I'm saying is, the best defense is offense. As you stay secure in the next level, you are looking forward to going up. That will help you to remain secure. If you allow the enemy to remain at the border, push them away. That means, let me come closer. There are people who are just saved. You remain there. You don't do anything. You don't advance. You know, when a wind comes, you are the one to backslide. You are the one who will be swept. But you know the way is push the boundary lines. Grow up. Push the enemy. Grow up. Increase. Hallelujah. You know, Jesus said in one of the scriptures, he said that those who are not with us, they are against us. Here is the way it is put. It's like those who don't work with us, they are against us. If you are doing nothing to push. Oh yeah, I put it up a lot, and my wife is helping me. It says this: those who don't gather with me scatter. You know what that means? You're doing nothing in the kingdom. You're doing nothing. You are doing nothing. Jesus said, those who don't gather with me, they, if you don't labor, you just there. Whatever you are, move forward. Move forward. Grow. Increase. That's why thanksgiving shakes us from pride and arrogance and prepares a way for the Lord to move you to the next level. Now, being thankful, I found a scripture, Luke 17, verse 11 to 19. I know you know the story. Jesus, there are these 10 lepers. You remember them? For those who know, chapter 17. They came to Jesus, and because lepers were not supposed to come and meet with the people, they stood far and said, Jesus, have mercy on us. And then Jesus said, told them, go and show yourself to the priest. If you don't understand why, it is the priest who used to declare you have leprosy. And it is the priest who used to confirm you don't have it. That's why Jesus told them, because it was under the old covenant, when you had leprosy, when you are healed, it was confirmed by the priest. And when you had leprosy that you are sick, he confirmed. And you are moved out of the community. Now, these men were not in the community, they were out because they were lepers. Now, when Jesus, they asked for healing, Jesus told them, he didn't lay his hands on them, he told them, go show yourself to the priest. And it is only when you show yourself to the priest, he's confirming whether you have leprosy. But remember this time, they had leprosy. Now, this is for another day, because it's about faith. That's for another day. I hear and I see a lesson of faith that we can rise up. Now, they walked by faith, they had leprosy. And they were going to show the
themselves to the priest. You know what? They looked on their skin. They were well. They were healed. The Bible says one of them was a Samaritan. When he realized he was healed, thanksgiving. When he realized he was healed, the Bible says he turned back. And you say, turn back. Yeah. They were going to show themselves to the priest when they were healed. Can you imagine? 10-1 decided, I am going to go against the current. It's about being thankful. This man turned, and the scripture says, he kept praising God. Can you read it? With a loud voice. Can I hear an amen? I want people to be thankful. God wants us to be thankful. I pray that Sitam Kiapuro will be a thankful church. Can you say amen? Would you be thankful? When he turned, he went, and the Bible says with a loud voice, I can only imagine, he came saying, I got it from the Lord. Hallelujah. I go back to him to say hallelujah and thank you, Lord. He came back praising God with a loud voice. He who offers praise, he glorifies me, and he makes a way for me to show him my salvation. He came, the Bible says, he came and cast himself down at the feet of Jesus and say, thank you. I just see you looking at me. Can you say amen? I am so, but I want you to see the truth. He came, cast himself down at the feet of Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, there are 10. Where are the 9? You get to the next level. And once you get there, proud. Oh my God. You know what these lepers did? I just think they say they have loved the touch for too long. We got it. Huh? What did you get? We got it. How we can go and show. The man, the Samaritan, went back saying, God, I thank you. And Jesus said, go home. Your faith has made you whole. You know what that means? Go home. You are going to next levels. The others have gone home, you know. They are thinking, I have been put out of the community. Now I am back. That is okay. But then be thankful. Hallelujah. That will shake your arrogance, my arrogance, my pride, and you'll be there praising God. And you know what the Bible says as we praise him? He dwells in the praises. He dwells in the thanksgiving. He will raise us to the next level. He will take us to the limit that you cannot even imagine. Hallelujah. Amen. Do you see the leper? Be thankful. Oh, the last, second last. Oh, be watchful. Number 4, be watchful. Listen, church. The next level can attract a lot of persecution. The next level, when God takes you there and does a new thing, it can attract a lot of persecution, a lot of fight. Let me tell you, as you rise to that level, I see it, the enemy is anointed. The devil is a thief, a murderer, and a destroyer. He hasn't changed his vision, but Jesus hasn't changed either. He is the good shepherd. He shepherds well. He came that we may have life and have it abundantly. But as you go to the next level, now, friends, watch. I mean, look and observe attentively. Exercise care. Take caution. I am saying, be watchful. The Bible says, above all else, in the book of Proverbs 4:23, guard your heart, for it is the wellspring of life. Above all things, guard your heart. Before you guard the level, because when you guard your heart, you can guard this place. Now Jesus said in the book of Luke, chapter 21 and verse 36, speaking about the last days, he said, watch and pray, lest you be trapped by covetousness and drunkenness and the chaos of this world, and fall rather than move. He said, watch and pray that you may be counted worthy, that you may escape all the things that will come and trap men.
and you'll be counted worthy to stand before the Son of Man. Jesus said, watch. And in watching, I mean, take care. When you think about the watchman, they stand at the gate. They are checking. They are looking. They are observing. They are exercising care. I am saying to us, be watchful. When you are that place, Jesus said, watch and pray, lest you fall in temptation. If you are not watchful, and one of the things that help you in watching, and that's why watching and praying are put together. Jesus said, watch and pray. In watching, remain in prayer. The book of 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8 says, be sober. The NIV says, be self-controlled and alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for somebody to devour. Verse 9, resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that your brothers throughout the world are undergoing the same kind of suffering. I want to say this, you are promoted, and all of a sudden you didn't have any trouble in the office. And the very moment you are lifted to that place, all over they are saying, he is an infected, he is the wrong man, all the things are said. You know, scandals can be put on you. I want to let you know that there is an enemy who does not want us in the next level. And when we get to the next level, we need to be alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a lion. He is not the lion. The lion of Judah keeps us secure. But he is like a lion. He looks for an opportunity to prowl on you, to plunder you. You need to be watchful. Be alert. When God gifts you and gives you things, I don't relax. The enemy retreats. Maybe you have persisted, you have persevered, you have labored, and once you get to that level, then what happens? You relax. Your enemy, my enemy, he retreats and says, okay, where can we hit? And if you're not alert, he will come. You find yourself, even in family, you know, things, good things happen, and when things good happen, you come and you realize there is no unity, there is confusion, and you start blaming one another, even in church, as the Lord lifts us, as the Lord blesses the families, as the Lord blesses us with ministry, even here, worship team, as we are lifted, we want to be alert. Because when we move to the next level, we have an enemy who is wondering, how can they escape? We want to bring them down. But you know, when we are that, we know that this confusion, we say, no, we are brethren. We have the same battle, we have the same law, and the same enemy. Our enemy is not our neighbor. Be alert, for your enemy, the devil. I like it. Peter puts it, your enemy, your enemy. Your enemy is not your neighbor. They are just incited by the devil. Your enemy is not your brother. You may be different and you are differing and there is trouble in the family. Oh, sorry about it. May the Lord intervene. But you as a believer realize there is an enemy. He prowls like a lion. And in fact, he targets those who have faith in God. Because when he confuses them and they change their battle, they start fighting the battle in flesh and blood. When our battle is not against flesh and blood, then he turns and he gets the victory. Be alert. You will be secure in the next level. I move to the last one. Number one, be sober. Number two, number three, number four, be watchful, be alert. And the last one, be a blessing. As you get to that level, rise with others. God called Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. This is what the Bible says. The Lord said to Abraham, leave your country, your people, and your father's household. Go to the land I will show you. Listen to verse 2. I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you. Say amen. Amen. And then he continued, God says, I will make your name great.
and you will be a blessing. Be a blessing. God called Abraham and told him, I'll make you a great nation. I will make you a name great. I will bless you, and you will be a blessing. The Bible says every believer who is born again and become a child of Abraham through Jesus, we that were outside have now become inside us. We are now the children of God. We are now the children of Abraham. We have the blessing of Abraham. It is ours. We have become partakers. The Lord told Abraham, I have blessed you to be a blessing. I have not elevated you. Just to elevate it, you will rise with the nations. Look at this sanctuary. Every blessing that has come to you, you know what? Abraham became a blessing. He opened his heart. He loved the Lord. He sacrificed. He loved the Lord that he was giving his son as a sacrifice. He loved God. He became a blessing. He was an intercessor. Because of that, I am born again. You are born again. Hallelujah. And the blessings of God come because God gave this testimony. Abraham became my friend. Become a friend of God. Those who love the Lord, they become a blessing. Rise with others. Look for the good of others. Don't just live for yourself. I read you the scripture, then I stop. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14 and 15. Listen to this as I close on the scripture. For Christ love compels, because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. Verse 15. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. The man God, the apostle said, don't live for yourself. Don't live for yourself. Be a blessing. Locate peace. There are people who depend on you for the next level. What we see in our nation, what we see in our community, you want to rise to the next level, you step on the shoulders of the people, they crash, you leave them cry. It doesn't matter. You grab it. You know what I'm talking about in this life. You know the pain. You know the cry. But the Bible says that the creation is groaning and is looking for the liberation and manifestation of the sons of God. Those ones that emulate Jesus, they don't live for themselves. Some of us, we get to the next level and you put the boundaries. You don't remember there are people who are hungry. There are people that need to be educated. God has endowed you with the next level. You can identify somebody. You can pay school fees. You can open a door for somebody. You can trust God to be a blessing. I pray that this church will not be a church where you come in. I, myself, and I go out, I'm blessed. Come in, I am blessed. And that is your life. We have it. No, the Bible says don't live for yourself, because Jesus died for all. He held nothing. He gave himself. And for that reason, God is calling us to be a blessing. Give yourself to somebody. And I pray as we move to the next level, we say we are lighting things here. I want to move to the next level. Think about others. Think about a family that is down that you can reach out and help. Think about somebody struggling. You can just be a blessing. Think about somebody. Locate a place. Locate somewhere that you can help. Don't keep everything to yourself. I want to say this. You have enough of the clothing. They are full in the wardrobe. They are pushing one another. There are very many. There are people who are looking for that blessing. You can be a blessing. Think about that. Think about us. Hallelujah. Be so. Please bow your heads in prayer. Bow your heads in prayer. Think about it. Think about it. be secure in the next world. We want not to be like Israel. We want to be like David. We want to be like Joshua. We want to be like Paul. We want to be like those who move ahead. We want to be sober. Think about it, sober. Calm, corrected, good sense, good judgment. Wisdom and level-headedness will keep you there. Do you want to be secure? Be humble. Don't be proud. Be gentle. Be submissive. That is not timidity. Allow the Holy Spirit to develop humility. This is not easy. It is not natural to be humble. We need to allow God to develop it. Humility will also move you to the next level. Those who are humble, they will be exalted. Be thankful. Be thankful. Tell your heart, be thankful. Thanksgiving takes us from pride and arrogance and prepares a way for the Lord to move you to the next level. God's will is the next level for you. Be watchful. Be watchful, my friend. Be watchful and be watchful. The next level can attract persecution. I don't know whether you're being persecuted, you are being fought. The enemy incites people to fight you. Be on guard. Your enemy is not that one. It is the devil. Guard your heart. The enemy is looking for your heart. Be watchful. Watch and pray. Be attentive. Exercise care. You will be secure. And finally, be a blessing. Don't live for yourself, friend. Let's make a decision. Jesus gave himself for us so that we can live for others. We are blessed to be a blessing. If you remain a blessing, God will keep raising you up. And therefore, bowing down your hands, you're thinking, Lord, help me. I've just said five things. May the Lord give you wisdom. May the Lord add to you understanding and counsel. And make us a people that will remain secure as we walk, as we run with the theme, just starting for the next level. And as the Lord leads us to the next level, we'll remain secure. None of us will fall down and be called a fool. None of us will be ungrateful and become arrogant. None of us will be unwatchful and the devil prowls in and destroy. None of us will be proud and be resisted by God. None of us will not be sober and know that what we have, we are stewards and God has given us. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you. We thank you. We submit to you. We submit to you, Lord. As you take us to the next level, Father, I pray you will help us to remain secure. As your word says in the book of 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 17 and 18. Therefore, dear friends, since you already know this, be on guard so that you may not be carried away by falsehood and far away from your secure position, but grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Father, I pray that you will help us. We will remain secure, will not be carried away by our selfishness, and will not be carried away by falsehood, will not be carried away by ungratefulness, will not be carried away by pride. But Lord, we will grow in grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus. We will move forward, I pray. We will be a people that will be a blessing to one another. I pray that, dear Lord, we will move on to the next level because you are the one doing the new things. I pray for those who are struggling. I pray for those who are fighting and those who are being fought left and right. You are the one who fights our battles. Whatever attracts opposition, you are the man of war. You will fight for us. I pray that, Lord, you will help us to locate somebody that we can raise up because we live for them. I pray you open our eyes to see the areas that we can become a shoulder and we can become a stepping stone for somebody to rise to the next level because you have blessed us, dear Lord. Help us to be selfless and to love you and to love you. Thank you, Lord. Blessed be your name. As we bow our heads,
has been this prayer. I want to ask you, are you in the house? And you're not born again. You want to give your life to Jesus. This is the greatest level. It is the beginning. We can talk about levels. We can talk about the step for next level. Jesus said, you get a whole world and lose your soul. It is nothing. Jesus is the answer. He is the way, the truth, and the life. Who wants to be saved? Do you want to receive Jesus as your personal Savior? Please lift that hand. I will see you. We pray together. Lift it up. Just lift it up. The Lord is speaking to you. The Lord is comforting you. Don't go home and say, lift up your head. I will see you. We pray together. Can I see your hand? I know you are there. I know you are there. You need Jesus. Are you there? Lift up that hand. Put it up. And make a master appeal. Are you there, Jesus? You say, Jesus, I am here. I want to receive you in my heart for forgiveness of sins. Are you there? Let me see your hand. I see a hand. Just put it up. Just put it up. Just put it up. Just put it up. Father, I thank you because of that hand. You are the Savior. And I ask, Lord, because you are no respecter of person, you say out of the mouth of infants, praises shall come to you. Lord, I pray that according to the faith of our heart, would you come into our heart. I ask you that you write our name in the book of life and change the narrative from today. I thank you and I bless her. I want to ask somebody to locate her so that after the service we can help her. Please let's stand on our feet. Let's stand and say the grace together.
I remind you again, be sober, be humble, be thankful, be watchful, be a blessing. And may the Lord give you wisdom and counsel to add to what I have spoken, that you may remain secure and that the Lord will keep lifting you. Now may the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord shine his face upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord cause you to be sober as he lifts you to the next level. May the Lord develop your heart to be humble and elevate you to the next level. May the Lord give your tongue and your heart an attitude of praise and thanksgiving that will prepare a way for the Lord to move you to the next level. May the Lord make you watchful, that you will not lose